tell me about Lithuania, because this is an interesting story. You wrote our people with a co-author who is very well known, very
Right.
well received in Lithuania for a while. Tell me about that experience of traveling through Lithuania and sort of uncovering the extent to which you see collaboration of Lithuanians, sort of the Holocaust distortion at play.
Listen, I'll tell you something. I think it's important to say this. When I started studying the Holocaust, I realized at a very early stage, if I want to have a life, I have to separate, I have to build a wall, so to speak, between myself and my profession, my, studies and activities and all that. And that wall was very effective and did its fulfilled its purpose until I went to Lithuania. Lithuania all of a sudden became a lot more personal. And in other words, I'm saying it's like it wasn't Franz Dorf against Dingo Šakić. It was the good guys against the bad guys. Okay. And I, but he already it took on a personal dimension because I'm named actually for my great uncle who was murdered in Lithuania, apparently by Lithuanians. And we know the date even, July 13th, 1941, there was a what they called the Action Against the Rabbis. And gangs of Lithuanian vigilantes were roaming the streets of Vilnius, I don't know, looking for Jews with beards. And my uncle, my great uncle apparently had one. We never saw a picture of him with a beard, but he apparently grew a beard at some point. And he was taken to the Lukashka's prison and either murdered there or murdered in Tonar, which is the site of mass murder. In any event, we chose the places that we went to, we chose based on our biographies. Now, both my grandparents were born in Lithuania, my grandmother in Chedova, my grandfather in Ligmenis, and of course, Ruta's family, Ruta Vanagaitė, she grew up in Lithuania. She's an ethnic Lithuanian, not Jewish. And she discovered that her grandfather and her aunt's husband were actively involved in the crimes of the Holocaust. And she wanted to atone for it, which was amazing. And she actually started a program to teach Lithuanian kids about Jews because she said she grew up in Lithuania. She didn't know anything about Jews. And the Jews that were Lithuanian, many of them actually had moved to Lithuania after the Holocaust, and they were not authentic in quotation marks Lithuanian Jews. In any event, so she got a grant from the EU and she took school children to the synagogue in Vilna. And I remember the community would tell them about Jewish history, Jewish traditions, holidays, etc. And then they did a beautiful ceremony in front of the Vilna City Hall on Holocaust Memorial Day, and then the kids were taken to Bonar. In Poznań, 70,000 Jews were murdered. It's the mass murder site of the Jews of Vilna and other places, in the entire area around there. But the grant required her to make a to c convene a conference on Holocaust education, but she didn't know who to ask. So she went to. I say jokingly, I don't know if you know what a mafer is. A mafer is a guy. Or male or female who's very involved in the apparatchik, so to speak, so in running things. So that she went to the people who were involved in Holocaust issues, like the Tennessee Holocaust Commission, for example. And she asked, "Well, who should I invite?" So they said, "You can invite anybody but two Jews, David Katz, who's a professor of Yiddish, who has a wonderful website called defendinghistory.com. About Lithuanian Holocaust distortion and Ephraim Zurov." So Ruta says, "Well, what's going to happen if I invite them? Is it going to be a fist fight?" No, it's not going to be a fist fight, but we don't want to sit next to them. We don't want to have anything to do with them." So Ruta, being a Ruta, of course, invited me. So this was the first time I had been invited to Lithuania in 20 years to speak publicly in 20 years. And they even offered to cover all my expenses, they didn't even pay me. Said, "Oh wow, that's wonderful," but I couldn't do it because I had committed to lectures in Indiana and Ohio because it was on Holocaust Memorial Day. So, but a month before that, I went to Vilna to protest against the neo-Nazi march in Vilnius. So I said to myself, I want to meet this woman. Who was this Luther Vanagaita character who invited me? It was so counterintuitive that I said, I have to meet her. Okay, so I met her. She tells me her relatives were involved in the Holocaust. I couldn't believe it. I'd been coming to Lithuania so many times, not a single person ever admitted that they even knew someone who was involved in killing Jews, okay? So we started talking, and we basically reached the situation, this is 2015, that we had run out of suspects in Lithuania. And as I tried to, you know, get the Lithuanian government to prosecute some of the Nazis actually who were deported to Lithuania from the United States. The United States, they couldn't be prosecuted for the crimes, but in Lithuania, they could be. And we put pressure on them, Israel put pressure on them, the United States put pressure. Not a single one, there were three trials, two were actually convicted, and not a single one sat one day in jail. And the height of the hypocrisy there was one guy was sentenced to 5 years in prison in jail in Lithuania, and they refused to implement the sentence because his wife was sick, not him even. Unbelievable, absolutely unbelievable. Anyway, so basically the fight was moving from the courtrooms to the arena of public opinion. In other words, to the schoolrooms, to the, you know, to the media, to all that. And I'm busy fighting, telling them all the time what the accurate narrative of the Holocaust is. And as Ruta explained to me, first of all, you came here from the very beginning, we got independence, and you started telling us we're a bunch of murderers. So what do you expect people to say? Yeah, coming from, and I said, you're coming from Brooklyn, you're a Jew with a kippah on, why should anyone believe you? She didn't say that, but I said it to myself. So I said, listen, my last chance, my last hope is someone like Ruta. She was one of the most popular authors in Lithuania, and she was much beloved because her last book was a book of advice to women at 50. And most of the women at 50, the small villages, feel that their lives are over. Husband ran away, or he's drunk, or he committed suicide, or don't ask, you know? So she gave them all sorts of advice how to sort of renew their life. And I tell you, I used to walk in Vilna in the street with Ruta, and women would come over her to hug her, kiss her, you saved my life, et cetera, et cetera. 50,000 copies in a country of 2.3 million people. It was unbelievable. So I figured this is the only way I can convince the Lithuanians, and I have to do it. So what did we decide? First, we had an idea maybe to offer to have a competition among high school kids, you know, to write about what happened in their town. But we couldn't be certain that they would speak to the right people. They could also speak to the wrong people. We had no time to train them. So we decided we're going to go on a mission. So we thought it would be 30. In the end, it was 40 places of mass murder where Lithuanians murdered Jews. And there's 234 mass Holocaust graves in Lithuania. So we chose the places based on our biographies. In other words, Ruta was no problem because she's from Lithuania. So in my case, where my grandmother was born, where my grandfather was born, where my uncle, my great uncle studied Torah in Panovich, for example, et cetera, et cetera. And everywhere we went, we taped our conversations. Everywhere we went, any elderly person who had lived through, we were looking for people who had actually lived through World War II. They were the ones who we stopped and we interviewed. And every single one we asked, well, can you tell us who carried out the murders? Every single one of these witnesses, and they're all non-Jews, because there's no Jews left in these places, the Lithuanians. That was shocking, absolutely shocking. But I'll tell you two stories. One is the following. In a town right near where my grandfather was born, I saw an elderly woman leaving a grocery store. And I said to Ruta, because I don't speak Lithuanian. So I said to Ruta, okay, Ruta, go ask this woman. She looks the right age. Okay. So this woman told the following story. She was 8 years old in 1941 when the decrees against, when Nazis invaded, and the decrees against the Jews began. She was friendly with a Jewish family, who also had a girl. Each family had two girls. each family, the girls, the two families, one was 14, approximately, the other one was 8. So her friend was 8 years old, a Jewish friend. And the other thing, and when the decrees against the Jews started, it looked like it was going to be real trouble. They had a very intense conversation in her home whether or not they could save her friend. So I told Ruta to ask her, you must have been afraid of the Germans. Because one of the things that Ruta impressed upon me was that many Lithuanians thought that the Germans will be there for a long time. There was the Germans not going to just, you know, take over Lithuania temporarily and then just let them be independent. So I asked them, through Ruta, I asked her, you must have been afraid of the Germans. She said, no, we were not afraid of the Germans. We could have hidden my friend forever from the Germans. We were afraid of our neighbors. And she started crying. It was so touching. So, I tell you, it was like the first time she could tell this story to someone who was sympathetic with her. You know what I mean? So understood her pain. I'll never forget it. So another story, short story. Every middle-sized town has a museum, municipal museum. So there's a town called Panubes, or we call it Panovich in Yiddish. And there was a very famous yeshiva there, very famous Jewish Talmudic academy, very famous to this day. And it was reconstituted in Israel. In any event, so we went to the museum in Panovich. 7,000 Jews were living in Panovich before the war. And only a couple of dozen survived. And now there's maybe a community, maybe 100 Jews or something. In any event, I asked the person who was in charge of speaking to guests and speaking to the media, I'm showing, is there anything in this museum about the Jewish community? He says to me, no. I said to him, are you aware of the fact that millions of people all over the world know the name of your town? He goes, why do they know the name of our town? I said, you know the bakery conditori opposite the bus station? That's the building of the Panovich yeshiva. Now, I explained to him what a yeshiva was. I explained to him that the rabbi who headed this yeshiva had escaped from Lithuania in 1940, came to Israel, reconstituted his yeshiva, and for many years, it was one of the best, most important yeshivot in the world, the Panovich yeshiva. He never heard of it. So I said to Ruta after we left, I said, I have to say it in Hebrew first, then I'll translate. Ratzachta, yarashta, machachta. Now, ratzachta is you murdered. Yarashta, you inherited. Machachta is you erased. Now, this is a takeoff. Anyone here knows Bible, you'll excuse me. It's a takeoff on a story about the prophet Elijah in the book of Kings, second book of Kings. King Ahab, the kingdom of Israel, lived next to someone who had a beautiful vineyard by the name of Navot. Okay? And King Ahab wanted to get his hands on that vineyard. So he went to Navot and offered him money to buy the vineyard. But Navot wasn't selling. So Ahab had him murdered. And he took over the vineyard. So not long after that, the prophet Elijah encountered the king Ahab. Just encountered him, you know. And Elijah said to Ahab, have you murdered and inherited? And it's a famous term. It is in Israel, in Hebrew, everyone knows that. You murdered and also inherited. So here it's you murdered, you inherited, and you erased. It was like a horrible feeling, absolutely horrible. Wasn't bad enough. You murdered our Jews. You stole their property, 50,000 households. The valuables and the belongings of 50,000 households in Lithuania. There were 220,000 Jews living in Lithuania under the Nazi occupation, of whom 212,000 were murdered. And there were less than 1,000 Germans in Lithuania at the time, during the Summer War. Anyway, this thing was, it's like a heartbreak or something. Every day, I mean, luckily, ultimately, it was a mission of 40 days, okay? And luckily for me and for Ruta, we didn't do it in one shot. That was, we did it by segments, 7 days. I think the longest was 10 days without Shabbat, of course. But sometimes it was only 3 days or 4 days, but it was 40 days. We also went to Belarus because a Lithuanian unit was sent to Belarus to bury Jews there, and they buried at least 20,000 Jews there. Interesting, apropos distortion, there's not a single monument in Belarus to the memory of these Jews that says that they were murdered by the Lithuanians. It's all peace-loving Soviet citizens were murdered by Hitlerite bourgeois fascist Hitlerites, something like that, you know? That's also distortion.
How important do you think it is to talk about Holocaust distortion?
Listen, it's super important because this is something that's under the radar. And I've spent the last 15 years documenting this phenomenon, speaking out against this phenomenon, trying to combat this phenomenon. And I will do whatever I can for as long as I can to fight this fight. Listen, I'll give you two examples, small examples, just from the week before. We had the holiday of Sukkot, Tabernacles, right before we left for the States. In Macedonia, the Bulgarians deported 99% of the Jews of Macedonia because Macedonia was turned over to Bulgaria by the Nazis when they carved up Yugoslavia, because Macedonia had been part of Yugoslavia. So they deported 7,200 Jews from Macedonia who were all sent to Treblinka. Every single one died. Not a single person returned. Okay, and now the Bulgarians are trying to deny that they deported those Jews to Treblinka. Now, Bulgaria is a very strange case because Bulgarians actually saved their own Jews, 50,000 Bulgarian Jews, because they were about to deport them to Treblinka, and then they changed their mind. And the reason they changed their mind is very interesting, because of civic opposition. The deputy speaker of the Bulgarian parliament, Dmitry Peshev, who was something of an anti-Semite, actually came out unequivocally against the deportation of the Jews. Metropolitan Stefan, Metropolitan Cyril, the church leaders of Bulgaria, against the deportation of their Jews. But they sent the Macedonian Jews to be murdered. And now they're trying to erase it. That's one thing. So there was a proposed law in the Macedonian parliament against any against the establishment of any cultural institution which will distort the Shoah. And Bulgarians had already built two cultural centers whom they named for Nazi collaborators. So I issued a statement supporting the legislation against, that's in Macedonia, Little Macedonia. In Hungary, the same week, a plaque honoring Admiral Horthy, who's the regent of Hungary during the Holocaust, the entire Holocaust, responsible for passing notorious anti-Semitic laws already in 1920, quarters on universities, non-Jewish university students, and basically gave the green light for the mass deportations of the Jews to Auschwitz. They built inside to have a special ceremony to honor, Admiral Horthy. So, I mean, this is crazy. Admiral Horthy doesn't deserve to be honored. He deserves to be vilified. So that just two little things in 1 week in two Eastern European countries, not to mention the main offenders. Lithuania is the main offender. Ukraine is a main offender. Croatia is a main offender. And Poland, under law and justice. This is crazy. They sued Barbara Engelking and Jan Grabowski, two fantastic historians who wrote about the role of Poles in the murder of Jews.
I was going to ask you about Professor Jan Grabowski, his book with Barbara Engelking just came out, Night Without End in English.
That in. Right.
Yeah, absolutely. So, one more question on Holocaust distortion before we sort of shift gears. how are we going to fight this trend? Because it seems to be continuing to grow in popularity along with anti-Semitism. I feel like you're seeing...
Listen, it's a new form of anti-Semitism.
Yeah.
Like I explained about how it was in Ireland this morning to the kids in the Loire High School. So what we're trying to do is create tools to tell the truth. So, for example, our book, which came out first in Lithuania, before it came out in English, and it's also out in 7 other languages already. It's coming out in Dutch soon, and we hope there'll be other languages. It's supposed to come out in Ukrainian as well, but I don't know. Now, with invasion, it's not clear if it'll come out. But we create the tools to tell the truth. And the book in Lithuania was a bestseller for several, number one in the bestsellers for several months. It was the most popular book in public libraries for 3 years running. 20,000 copies were sold. By the way, the only reason it got published was because the publisher, who Ruto was writing for, wanted to keep Ruto writing for them. So we went to speak to the publisher about the book. And this is after she wrote a runaway bestseller about advice to women, right, at age 50. So before she could say anything, the head of the publishing company said, Ruta, you had such a great success with your book about women. Why don't you write a book about men? So Ruta says, yeah, that's a good idea. I'll do it. But first, you're going to publish the book I'm writing now. Wonderful, Ruta. What are you writing? About the Holocaust. Wrote in him. She said to them, you want me to keep writing for you? You're going to publish this book. So actually, they made a condition, which was very smart. The condition was not to say a single word about the book until it comes out, the day it comes out. The day it came out, the government was totally unprepared. The head of national security goes on national television. This book is a threat to Lithuanian national security. So the U.S. Embassy called them up and said, you know, get a life. What are you talking about? Now, of course, 5 years later, no, more, you know, 6 years later, with the invasion of Ukraine, maybe the guy was right.